KTTZ-TV Channel 5 presents 24 Frames, taking you inside music, art, and entertainment in the Hub City and beyond.
Tonight on 24 Frames, we meet two local artists who are recycling more than just garbage by giving new life to the written word. We sit down with Ken Burns' longtime producing partner, Dayton Duncan, to talk about their filmmaking process and their new production, The Dust Bowl, premiering on PBS November 18th and 19th. We'll take you to the Lubbock Arts Alliance to talk with Dirk Fowler about his Texas music poster collection. And finally, we'll hear from a local Texas artist, Daniel Fluitt. Hi, I'm Paul Hunton, and welcome to 24 Frames. When we talk about recycling, you probably think of your old plastic bottles or paper bags. But two artists in Lubbock are taking old mediums of expression and making them new again. Keith Kohanic has the story.
I've been working with words and type and books for about 6 or 8 years now. I just tried to see them as what they really are, as opposed to something that, you know, holds knowledge or, you know, contains imagination, but just as a, you know, block of wood. So meet again after several years. There's an initial, oh my goodness, you're destroying this beautiful set of encyclopedias, you know, and then of course my immediate response is usually, well, when was the last time you looked in one? We're essentially exchanging immediate information that's possibly inaccurate for, you know, outdated information that really is inaccurate. It's this bulky thing that you can't move everywhere and you don't know what to do with. And so that initial reaction of, oh, you destroyed something, quickly turns into something that you've created. I was looking at objects, I mean, the normal, everyday, mundane objects, trying to find a way to make a sphere out of it. The book was such an important object to me throughout my life, but I wanted to use it within my art, and so in order to find a way to do that, I had to change its shape.
Whitfield walked me through his process of creating the sculptures. He starts by ripping out pages to transform the books into wedges.
I don't destroy specific books, you know. I'll never destroy a science fiction book, you know. Sure. Even a crappy science fiction book,
there's
I'll probably.
Some things that are sacred.
That's right. So before you got here, I measured our smallest book, which was 7.5 inches, and we're going to cut it in half, and then we're going to cut all the other books at the same, mark. Basically, I'm taking and just seeing if my wedges are correct, tessellating the edges a little so I can have some variety. So a lot of what I'm doing, and with the resin in particular, is trying to save things that normally would be destroyed, and if they weren't, will degrade. And those books are going to basically fall apart into nothing. So I'm kind of giving them an extended life and paying homage.
Whitfield isn't the only local artist working with items from the past. Texas Tech professor and artist Carol Flukiger does too. She uses old literature, handwriting, and more in her art.
Repurposing the primary documents of early American history has just been a real ride into the past. That history is so interesting to me and so, in a way, unresolved and still open-ended, and we're still re-looking at all of that. I guess my way of engaging with that is to re-examine it in the studio and illuminate it with the Texas sun, the blistering West Texas sun. I remember always writing about my work on painted panel and cyanotyping on panel and being very interested in digitizing the handwriting of historic figures and then blueprinting it into a painted surface. And I always talked about that and said, I like to try on history, or I'm I'm trying on history like a pair of jeans and a t-shirt. I thought, you know, I should, instead of having that in my imagery, I should go a step further and actually blueprint onto clothing and try the clothing on that's been blueprinted onto.
Okay, so I can coat the whole shirt or I can coat a portion of it, and then it needs to dry. A large transparency, and I'm just gonna lay it over the top of it. And I might do something like put it on sideways. And we're ready to roll it outside for 5 minutes. You can watch the yellow burn out to a very neutral gray. I like the idea of collaborating with nature to make work. We'll rinse it down. And that's, you know, that's it. Your artwork is right there in front of you. It's just this idea of continuing to use it and not to take it for granted.
You may know Ken Burns' name from the effect Apple computers named after him on their iMovie video editing software. Or you may have seen one of his award-winning films on PBS. Either way, Ken Burns is an American treasure, one of the finest filmmakers who tells epic stories of how this country came to be one of the greatest in the world. From the Brooklyn Bridge to the Civil War, and this year, the Dust Bowl, Florentine Films, Ken Burns Movie Company, tells important historical stories with a scope unlike even the biggest Hollywood studios. Recently, I sat down with Florentine Films producer Dayton Duncan to talk about how they make movies.
We do take more time than most people do. Ken believes that the greatest gift you can give to a project is a little more time, which was one of the reasons that when he first started being a filmmaker that he moved to this rural part of New Hampshire where it's cheaper to live than New York City, where most filmmakers in the East Coast would have ended up. And that allows us to take a little longer, to open ourselves to question whether we're going down the right way, or whether maybe after we show it to some experts and some other people and they say, you know, I'm kind of confused here, or you're missing the point there, that we aren't in such a rush just to finish it, that we're locked in to a specific way of telling our story. And so we do things a lot differently, I think, than many other film companies in the terms of time, in the terms of how we use our music, in the terms of just the progress of what we do, but we think it works pretty well.
Their most recent film, The Dust Bowl, is unlike any other they've produced. Instead of relying on narrators and voice actors, they felt it was important for this film to be told by those who lived through the greatest man-made ecological disaster in history.
The great thing about it is that we could do a documentary film on the Dust Bowl without the living survivors of it. I mean, we did a film on Lewis and Clark that I wrote, and we didn't get the chance to interview Meriwether Lewis or William Clark, you know, it was 200 years ago. So the story of the Dust Bowl is important enough, there's enough photographs and other things. We could do a Florentine Films and pretty good documentary, but it wouldn't be what we think this film is, which is more than any film we've ever done. It is this oral history of people, and it's interesting because a young person for us would have been 85 when we're interviewing them. I mean, they ranged from 85 to the high 90s. But they're telling their memories are from when they were kids. And I think what enlivens our story is you really understand how catastrophic it was, because people, you know, 75 years later, it's like it was yesterday to them.
The Dust Bowl airs November 18th and 19th at 7 p.m. on Channel 5.
It's time for 24 Frames Trivia. Which film was Ken Burns' first documentary? Was it A, The Civil War, B, Baseball, C, Jazz, or D, Brooklyn Bridge? The answer when we return to 24 Frames. It's time for 24 Frames Trivia. So So which film was Ken Burns' first documentary? The answer is D, The Brooklyn Bridge. Ken Burns produced this film in 1981 and was subsequently nominated for the Academy Award for Documentary Filmmaking. Now, back to 24 Frames.
The Thrift Store Cowboys have been touring together for a decade. Shaking the Texas country label early on, their sound has been described as gypsy desert music. In our new series, South Plains Sessions, we get a private performance from their lead man, Daniel Fluitt. Jonathan Seaborn has more.
So I'm here with Daniel Fluitt of the Thrift Store Cowboys.
Howdy.
So Daniel, how long have you been involved in the music scene here in Lubbock?
I have been, I guess, living in Lubbock and playing music here for almost 13 years now. So it's been a really long time.
How exactly did Thrift Store Cowboys come to be, Daniel?
Well, I've been playing music with Colt Miller and Jeff Dennis, who's our original guitar player, since we were sophomores in high school. And so we just kind of started with like our high school band. And once we got to college, Jeff moved away for a semester, Colt moved away for a semester. And I went to school at South Plains College. And then they ended up, we all kind of came back to Lubbock and decided we wanted to keep playing music. But, you know, we couldn't, you know, have a band called Tater Reds and the Wonderful Ibex Fabrication. So we ended up changing it to Thrift Store Cowboys and writing, kind of honing in and finding what kind of style of music we want to play and everything like that. So that's kind of how we started out playing.
So your songs seem to be more haunting than most other bands in the same genre as you guys. Is that something that you set out specifically to do when you're writing songs, or does that just come naturally?
I guess we've always kind of been a lot darker about our subject material and just the way that Colt plays the guitar and different things, and it's a lot more minor chords and stuff like that. So it's just kind of like I'll take something that he wrote music-wise, and then I'll take it and write lyrics kind of just how I'm feeling at the moment. So it's, you know, one song could be happy, one song could be sad, one song the music-wise could be happy, but the song is completely depressing. So it really just depends. But it's not like we're going for that sound, it just kind of comes out of the way we play. So.
Well, Daniel, thanks for having us in your house.
Yeah.
And here's Daniel Fluitt playing some songs in his living room.
Today's the epitome of what I should have known. All along became immersed in just one thing. In unsuccessful sources burn like the pain from the sad inability to feel, to know what it feels like. And all the fire is gone. And all of our fields have all grown. Girl, speak not to my face, but to my telephone. I figure what the hell went wrong. Well, I figure what the hell went wrong. When your closet's full of bridal bones, nothing to find where you don't want to be seen. Couldn't even pick my throat up off the floor to speak the words, to see anything at all. Oh, speak the words, to say anything at all. Thank you. away along with the sun. Can't account for the gradual weight. And this murder up crows, no one knows, it's hard to know where and when. And who's throwing actual stones? Well, frankly, I just don't give a damn, but I'm damned if I don't. Yeah, I just don't give a damn, but I'm damned if I don't. When your closet's full of rattle bones, still there's nothing to find where you don't want to face it. Couldn't even pick my throat up off the floor to speak the words, to say anything at all. Won't speak the words, to say anything at all. Won't speak the words.
It's time for 24 Frames Trivia. In the film Harvey, starring James Stewart, what was the name of Stewart's character? Was it A. Billy, B. John, C. Elwood, or D. Humperdinck? The answer when we return to 24 Frames. It's time for 24 Frames Trivia. So what was James Stewart's character's name in the film Harvey? The answer is C. Elwood. Stewart plays the delusional Elwood, who sees an invisible 6-foot rabbit named Harvey in one of his finest performances. Now, back to 24 Frames.
If you've ever been to a concert, you've seen some sort of poster advertising the band and the event. That flyer, however, is not just an advertisement. It's usually a handcrafted work of art. Texas Tech graphic design professor and music poster artist Dirk Fowler recently put together an exhibit at the Lubbock Arts Alliance of some of his poster work, as well as other gems from his collection.
From Texas, but I made my way from Dallas.
Well, I'm interested in all music, Texas in particular. Of course, Lubbock, Texas has a long tradition and history in music. I've been a working poster artist for about 15 years now. I was approached by the Lubbock Arts Alliance to and asked to pull together a show in conjunction with the Lubbock Music Festival. So I selected from my own collection some of my own work, as well as work by friends and peers in the concert poster world.
Once I was a carpenter, and man, my hands were calloused.
What I tried to select for this particular show was either posters made by a Texas poster artist, or advertising for a Texas music venue, or advertising a Texas music artist. Somehow, hopefully, they all tie into Texas. They're not all specifically Lubbock, Texas, but Texas.
Yeah.
An advertisement is essentially ephemeral. It's meant to be thrown away. It's not meant to be kept. We're artists. We like the idea of making something that connects to the band. It connects to the music scene. You take it home as a commemorative to enjoy or to remember the joy you had, the experience from the show. So the artistic side for myself and for most of the artists doing this is very important.
Won't be scared to die.
And that's it for 24 Frames on Channel 5. Remember to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and find extras at kttz.org. If you know a local musician or artist who you'd like us to profile on the show, shoot me an email at paul.hunton@ttu.edu. Thank you for joining us.
Wanna get behind the wheel, but only one rider. I Chef Bill got me swimming like a diver. Tank let go, I got fans in Okinawa. My heart to Japan, quake, losers and survivors. Norway, no, you didn't get my flowers. No way to say it better, but the killer was a coward. Face just showered, a minute in the hour.